Welcome, everyone. I'm Dev Petit with the Sports Facilities Company, and today we have what I think has to be perhaps the most exciting collection of minds to have the conversation about sports tourism and the post-COVID era. There's no question that the group of people here today have played a very significant role in the landscape of youth sports and sports tourism over the last two decades. And there's no question that the work they're doing now, each of them, both independently and in collectives, is going to influence the landscape that we all have to play in the next 20 years. We're going to start with Tom Cove from the Sport and Fitness Industry Association. Then we're going to hear from Alan Kidd, Sports ETA, formerly the National Association of Sports Commissions, representing every destination in America that's trying to attract sport, all of that economic activity. We're going to hear from Clay Walker at the National Fitness Foundation, who's doing transformational work, really trying to impact policy so that for generations to come, kids have access to sport. And we're going to hear from Jason Clement, co-founder of the SF Companies and the creator of the SFM Network. What's happened in sport over the last, call it 10, 20 years, and where are we now, and where do you see us going?
Okay, let's talk about where we were when we came in and where we are now. So first, coming into this year, we were actually seeing some good news. Overall team sports participation was up, although 16 of the 23 team sports subjects that we cover was down. So the big ones, flag football, baseball, basketball, volleyball, were up. And so this kind of a mixed bag story. But in general, having more people playing team sports coming into 2020 is a very strong idea, because historically, we have seen some in the last 15 to 20 years, some degradation of that as intensity related to travel, competitive, single sport specialization has gone up. The trend has been overall numbers have gone down, and there's issues around specialization, injury, but there's also issues around cost. So now we go into this year where cost is going to be a big issue relative to access to sports. So we're watching it closely. First, travel and elite play and organizations have come back faster than the rec side. We anticipate, we see that in large measure because people are committed to a sport. They're also committed to an organization. They know the coach. The coach calls them and says, we have protocols. We've identified the fields. We promise we'll take care of you. People will go. Going back into a rec situation, they're not as likely to do that. They don't know the people. They're not as familiar, et cetera. So there's that trust factor that's going to have to be built up at the rec level. Same thing. And frankly, just not as committed. You know, a seven-year-old playing soccer compared to a 14-year-old that's played soccer for 7 years is a different commitment to the sport.
What are you hearing from those marketplaces as it relates to where youth sports and sports tournaments will stack? What's going to come back first? Will conventions be first? Will they be last? Where is that group travel business expected to start?
You know, around the country right now, 94% of the funding for convention bureaus comes out of hotel taxes. That's impaired. So we know that's a problem. Group travel, if you look at any of the group travel from the tourism industry, is crushed right now. And there's not a lot of interest coming back. Youth sports will be the first on the sport tourism side that will engage, but it'll be different engagement than it was before, and it will have significant effects. In some markets right now, as you know, Myrtle Beach and some of the others, they're crushing their growth right now because they're open. So youth sports are going to play a significant role in reinstituting the comeback of the tourism industry.
But as team sports continues to rise and our participation grows, we're also seeing within the communities that we serve a large number of constituents not able to play because the cost to play has continued to increase. And it's not just because of the travel, which is a great program and a great offering and provides a great service to those that get to participate, but it's also because of the cost to develop these complexes and this arms race that's happening in many communities across the country that, you know, the development of new complexes paused for just a couple of months, really from March into June, and it has just continued to explode again. those that cannot afford to play aren't getting to play. And the downstream effects of that community that doesn't get to play, whether it's in local league, camp, clinic, or in travel play, it's a real problem. And so what we've done is we've innovated what we call the Access Program. And what we're trying to do is partner local community leaders, whether that's not-for-profit organizations or the corporate sponsorship dollar, which, by the way, is reducing as a result of COVID. And even before that, less and less corporate or companies want to put a sign on the outfield fence or on the gymnasium wall. But they are very interested in helping scholarship or sponsor kids and youth that otherwise wouldn't be able to participate and play.
And can you speak about what you see as important in the months and year ahead as it relates to policy and policies that can support improved access to sport?
But in terms of public policy, this has been mentioned by Tom and Al as well. It really, I don't believe, can succeed if it's private sector only. And I don't think it can succeed if it's public sector only. And I think that what we've got to have in 2021 is a real push to make sure that there are not just the state and local partnership level deals happening, but at the federal level. And that's quite frankly part of our responsibility as the official charity of the President's Council, is to lean on Congress, is to lean on the administration to really get consensus behind the idea that if we commit to this, we can improve health outcomes in America.
What are some of the things you see as important in terms of the role of the Fed, and how do you see the public-private partnerships playing a role in executing and delivering at the ground level, at the hyper-local level?
One of the things that we think about in terms of what the federal government's role should be is to fill gaps, to fill voids where the private sector can't or won't or isn't prepared, isn't best situated, best positioned to fill those gaps. And a couple of examples, I will just use the word infrastructure. And we think of it as two types. One is human infrastructure. And that's a big gap, not in affluent communities, but in less affluent communities. There's a pretty big gap in terms of coaches, in terms of referees, in terms of managers, in terms of really some of the human infrastructure necessary to run and manage youth sport programs. So that's one area that we are taking a really hard look at and coordinating now with AmeriCorps to come up with a broad-based national solution, working with the folks that, you know, like PCA or Up to Us, organizations that do that for a living, figuring out how do we create our own sort of internal domestic Peace Corps, if you will, of youth sport volunteers. So that's one infrastructure piece that you really need government to engage around that. Number two would be facility infrastructure, which you and I have spoken about a lot. And that is an area that we think we have to really get out of the next infrastructure bill money, serious money, that is dedicated to sport and recreation facilities.
There's a couple of parts, one related to tourism and one related to better community value. And one of the first things that's going on right now with the tourism side is the incremental tax districts are growing and expanding. There's the first cannabis tax district came into California, believe it or not. There's wine districts now that have been formed. Originally, they were hotel districts, hotel taxing districts. There's now, if you look at Virginia Beach, there was a district formed just to help fund a facility. $68 million was raised. They're onto something there. They need to spend more time actually thinking about the broader good of which sports can do and contribute.
Well, thank you. We could not have more influential and powerful and heartfelt leadership group on this roundtable today. Your inspiration around this and your commitment to the well-being of kids and to sport in America is energizing. And hopefully the audience has experienced that as well. And they're thinking differently about these topics and specifically thinking about how they can engage at their local level and how policy is really what's most important to the future of sport in America now. We've got to find ways to reinvest in sport.